Hi, and welcome to the Microsoft Virtual Academy session on 20 C-Sharp Questions Explained. My name is Jerry O'Brien, and I'm a Content Development Manager here at Microsoft, and I'm joined today by Paul Pardee.
Good to be with you, Jerry.
Good to be with you, Paul. So let's talk a little bit about who we are, a little bit of background on the two of us. As I said, my name is Jerry O'Brien. My Twitter tag is up here at Jerry OB. Don't spend a whole lot of time looking at it because I don't spend a whole lot of time writing on it, but I am there occasionally. I'm a technical content development manager here at Microsoft. I'm a content author, and I focus pretty much on our software developer and some of our database platform content when we write it here. Somewhere over 18 years in the industry, 9 of those have been here at Microsoft. Most of it in our learning experiences team. And I focus on, as I said, content development. I've been a software developer, consultant, and a trainer in the past and still hold my Microsoft certified trainer status. Written a few books and currently program in a bunch of different languages, Visual Basic, C#, Java, a little bit of iOS programming in Objective-C. And at some point, I would like to learn C++, but we'll get there. Now I'll turn it over to Paul to introduce himself.
Hi, my name is Paul Pardee, and I'm a content development lead here at Microsoft. I'm closing into my 15th year at the company, and I've done a lot of different roles. I was a software development manager for a while, and I worked in Windows in the content publishing division, and now I'm with Microsoft Learning Experiences, and my team works on the great MVAs that you see here at Microsoft Virtual Academy, as well as the classroom training. I've developed a lot of software in my history, mainly focusing on C#. So I've done a lot of C# development. In fact, I have a Windows 8 app in the App Store and a Windows Phone app in the App Store. And both of those are written in C# and XAML. So I've got a lot of background with C#. Also done some JavaScript programming and a very little bit of C++, Jerry. Not an expert, but I've done a little bit of that work as well. And finally, I published a book on Microsoft Access back in the 90s. So I love software, and I'm really happy to be able to talk about the 20 top questions of C# today.
Good stuff. Thanks, Paul. And so once again, as you see, the title here is 20 C# Questions Explained. What we did was we actually took a look at some of the items that we found available on the internet that folks are asking about questions for C#. Now, these might be students who are obviously trying maybe to find an answer to their homework, or sometimes it just may be beginner programmers who are trying to figure some stuff out with C#. So what we've done is we've basically culled that information, took a look at what we saw as the top 20 C# questions based on the votes that people have given them, based on the number of views that some of the other people have looked at. And you can see a sampling of what these are here on the screen. So we're going to cover in this session, in individual chunks for each one, each of these 20 C# questions. Paul, anything you'd like to add for this?
Yeah, just that, of course, you can find the answers to all of these questions on the internet somewhere. But what we're going to try to do is walk you through the code and actually talk a little bit about how these answers work. So we think there's value here in actually seeing two folks walk through the code, and that's what we're going to try to provide today.
Yeah, and that's a great point. So that's kind of what we've decided we're going to focus on as we demonstrate these. We'll take a look at the code that actually provides the functionality, that answers the question that has been asked. And myself, I'm a visual learner, so I realize that a lot of times that there are folks out there who are trying to learn some of this stuff, and they're just not able to look at it because it's too abstract for them. It doesn't give them that sort of the information that they need from the visual perspective. So that's kind of why we decided that we'll show the question, we'll talk about the answer to it, and we'll actually demonstrate the code that kind of solves that problem for you. And in this way here, not only does it give you the answer to the question, but it shows you how to do it and gives you some insight into maybe even just the thought process behind some of that code. So that's what we're going to focus on today. And we'll take a look at the first one. The first question that came up was, when do we use a struct versus a class? So in C#, as well as some other object-oriented programming languages, we have the ability to create a structure in the code, or we have the ability to create a class in the code. And some folks who are new to dealing with object-oriented programming, or even C# in general, are kind of saying, well, a struct and a class almost look the same. Why would I use a struct over a class, or why would I use a class over a struct? If we take a look very quickly at some of the bullet points that are listed on here, structs are really value types, which mean that their memory allocation is a little bit different than what you would find for a class. A class is considered a reference type. And if you're not sure what a value type and a reference type means, essentially a value type is stored on what we call the stack. So that's a logical area of memory within the computer. a class is actually stored on the heap, so it's allocated in a different logical location for the memory on the computer itself. And how we access those and reference them are a little bit different. Primarily, you're going to use a struct mostly for smaller data type structures, and the reason being is because it impacts the performance of your application sometimes, depending on how large that struct is. And the reason being is because when we pass a struct value to a method or as we manipulate it within our program, we pass the entire data structure. So all of the information that's stored in that struct all gets passed on the stack itself. The stack is actually a smaller memory allocation than the heap, typically on most computers and the way the compilers deal with it. If we pass a class, we actually pass a reference to the object, which means only the memory address. So it's a much smaller piece of information that gets passed back and forth in the computer's memory itself. So as we take a look at, you know, with the classes themselves, the important thing to consider is that if we make a change in a struct, we make a change in a copy of the struct. That's by definition how a value type works, is we pass a copy of that value. With a class, we're passing a reference to the class itself, which means anytime we make a change to the value in the class, we're actually going to make a change to the original object itself because we're passed a reference to it in memory. Let's step out to a demo in Visual Studio and see what that looks like. Okay, so here we are in Visual Studio 2013, and what I have created in my code is there's a structure here, and it's known as a point struct. So it's just a standard structure to represent a point in our application. And we have two public member variables. They're integer types, x and y. That's for the location of the class. And then we have a constructor. So like a class, a structure can have a constructor. And we pass in two integer variables and assign them to those member variables. Now, here's our class. So we've created a class as well called point class. And it looks exactly the same as our structure. So in terms of what we got for member variables and we have a constructor, it looks identical to the struct that we just took a look at. So we have, again, the two private or public member variables for x and y, and then we have a constructor that assigns those values. Now, let's take a look at what we're going to do in the code with this. And what we're going to do initially is create a new structure, and we're going to call it struct point, and we're going to assign it two values. So we're going to assign 10 to the x and 10 to the y. We'll output to the console what those values are. Then we're going to call a modify struct point method. So excuse me while I scroll for a moment here. We have a modify struct point method which takes the structure that we have created, assigns the value 20 to the xy. So we're changing the xy values. We'll simply output to the console a message saying we're inside this method, and we'll show what those new modified values are. Then we will step back out of that method and we will show what our struct values are still outside of that method. And then we're going to do exactly the same thing with the class, and we'll see the differences as to how those function. So let's go ahead and execute this code. So Control F5 brings up my command window, and we see that we have our initial struct values are 10 and 10, and we know that because we assigned them here. We step inside the modify struct point method, and we change the modify values to 20 and 20. Again, as you saw in our code down here for the modify, this is exactly what we did. So we have now the two values, 20 and 20. Then as we step back out of the modify struct point method and we come back up and output the struct values again, notice that they go back to 10 and 10. Again, the reason being is because when we executed that method, we only passed a copy of the struct. It got passed on the stack, it's a value type of a data structure. So we only modified a copy. We didn't actually make any changes to the original structure that we created. Now, if we look at the class and see what happens, we see that, again, we set the initial values of 10 and 10 for the x, y in the class. But now we call a modify class point method. And I just want to point out that there's nothing different in this method. If you look at it, we're not doing anything different in the modify class point than we are in the modify struct point method. Okay, they're doing exactly the same thing. Where the differences come into play is that in the modify struct point, we passed a value, so it's a copy of that struct. But in the modify class point, because class is a reference, we're passing the memory address. And as a result, we're able to modify the 2020, so our modified values inside that method are modified, same as they were with the struct. But when we step out of that method and come back, we see that our initial class has now changed, and 2020 are the values, because we have modified the original class value. So that's the primary difference between the class and the struct. One is a value type, one is a reference type. When you make changes to a struct, you make changes to the copy of it, of the actual struct itself. the original remains unchanged. But the class is a reference, so you're actually modifying the original value. So that completes question number one, the difference between a struct and a class. And again, keep in mind, the simplest part of it is a struct is a value type and is typically passed on the stack. And anytime you modify it within a method that you pass it into, you're only modifying a copy of that struct. When you're dealing with a class, you're passing a reference to it, which is the memory location or the memory address for that, and you will modify the original value.